A very good evening. You're watching NewsX. I'm Gauri Dwivedi. You're watching a very special broadcast on NewsX as we talk about, well, what are some of the industry captains saying as far as the stimulus announced by the government last week. On Sunday, the last leg of the 20 lakh crore stimulus announced by the government in terms of breakup was announced. How has really that been received by the industry in this very special broadcast in tie-up with Business World? All right, Mr. Hemant Kanoria, Chairman of SRAE, Rajan Matthews, DG COAI, which is essentially the body for telecom operators, Uddhav Poddar, MD, Bhumika Group, Mahendra Swaroop, MD and partner of Avigo Capital Partners, SS Mantha, former Chairman AICTE, Janardhan Pandey, who is founder and MD of Net Value, Mansi Gupta, founder CEO of Tijori, as well as Anurag Batra, Chairman and Editor Chief of Business World. All right, you know, let me start with you, Mr. Kanoria. You know, we've all got time to now digest the breakup of the 20 lakh crore. There have been some concerns with several industry leaders like Kiran Majumdar Shaw, who's said that she's disappointed. How do you read what the FM's announcements have been?
I think the slew of measures which have been announced for the economy, these are good points which have been covered, and many of the sectors have been covered in this. In the medium and to the long term, it will have definitely very good effect because there are new investments in many of the sectors which the government has announced. But in the short term, I think that because of the MSME companies which will be getting some loans on the basis of a guarantee from the government, the NBFCs especially, where we are concerned because being an NBFC, and it was very important for us to get the liquidity and the funds also from the banks, etc. Everywhere the loans which have been announced and with the guarantees, so it will take some time for the government to roll it out, maybe anywhere between 2 weeks to 2 to 3 months time. So in the medium to long term, it will definitely have a good effect. But in the short term, what is required today is immediate infusion of liquidity to the businesses so that the businesses can restart. So there are certain measures which we have already from the industry, and specifically from the industry which I represent, we have requested the government for, and I think that over a period of time they should be responding to that, but we are still awaiting those short-term measures, and that is why I think that industry in general may have got a little disappointed, because they were expecting that the short-term measures, which is very much critical, should be announced at first, and then secondly, in the second order, they could have announced these particular measures which they have done for the medium and long-term benefit of the economy.
Okay, let me get in Rajan Matthews. Mr. Matthews, you know, the sector that you represent didn't find much of a mention in the FM's announcements. Do you think there'll be some trickle-down effect on Indian telecom?
So I think, Gauri, we are well past trickle-down economics. I think we have to get to the point where the cascading benefits of this industry has to be clearly recognized. I think if at any point in our time, if the value of our networks has to be recognized, it's at this time. So we would have expected that in order to stimulate the overall economy, the benefits would have been given to our industry. Just by way of a data point, before the COVID pandemic, our industry was contributing 6% to GDP. During the COVID period, we are now contributing 35% to the GDP. So you should understand what the cascading benefits of our industry would have been in terms of kickstarting the industry and in kickstarting the economy. Unfortunately, nothing seems to have been done to address the long-standing issues of the industry, which is one, infuse liquidity, two, take the sort of pressure off. 30% of every revenue goes to the government. Reduce that and help the industry.
Mr. Matthews, you can give me credit for understanding this sector. All I can say is that I don't think there's going to be any streamlining of levies right now and taxes because the government's finances are stretched. I don't think you'll get any elbow room even in the 5G spectrum pricing. Again, the logic being the government's finances are stretched. So Realistically speaking, what is it that you can now look forward to in terms of government handholding the sector, as you said, which is so crucial for the economy?
So I think one of the things that very clearly the government can do, and by the way, the points that you make, Ari, are probably impactful of every sector in terms of the contributions. But let me get to the point you raised. One, I think you can incentivize the industry in terms of saying, look, our interest is in kickstarting infrastructure rollout. This is something that's been talked about. Just as you build roads, you get money into the hands of employees and workers. Begin to help us incentivize, start rolling out fiber. This is absolutely critical. Help us to continue to roll out the networks. Again, this is our investments, right? But give us an incentive so that the employment can again kickstart. This cascades to the OEMs because they will start manufacturing. They will start calling back people to start working in the factories to employ. Exports will start kicking off because again, these manufacturers export a tremendous amount of items and sets. Again, help us begin to start kickstarting that, and again through incentives, and again employment will start. So the demand side of the equation very quickly gets impacted by helping our side of the equation.
Okay, let me then quickly now also rope in Anurag Batra to come in there with his perspective, with his two bits, and then he can also of course rope in some of the industry veterans with us on the broadcast. Anurag.
You know, Gauri, on this special broadcast every week, we've been talking to industrialists, entrepreneurs, leaders of the industry, representatives. And the one sentiment over the last 4 days has been that government has done well, but it's not enough. So that's the sentiment. And my input to them have been that they've built a business without government support. So they have the capability and the innovativeness to be able to navigate. This is of a very grave nature. This is of a very different nature. But, you know, entrepreneurs build businesses for now and future. So I'm sure the entrepreneurs can innovate. The third thing I've said, and I'm repeating, that this is possibly stage one, installment one. There will be a stage two, there will be an installment two, and possibly the government will look at sectoral, you know, measures. You know, Mr. Kanodia comes from the infrastructure sector. He lends to the infrastructure sector. And really, that is the sector that needs to be rejuvenated, because that will create job opportunities, that will create work for the whole ecosystem, and it will also create long-term economic clusters, which will then contribute to GDP. So I would say the government has moved in the right direction, but a lot more is expected, and I'm sure it will happen. And the government doesn't want to get the demand going in the next 30 days. We don't want everyone to go out and start, you know, being in malls. And so I think it's a supply side is being restored at some stage. Even on the demand side, things will restore. Those are my comments, and I'll come in later.
Okay. You know, I want to rope in Uddhav Poddar as well to come in there and respond and take on from what Anurag just said in terms of forward-looking statements, important policy announcements, but probably not enough.
Hi, Gauri. Thanks for having me on the show. Yes, I agree with Mr. Batra that while the announcements are nice, but they're definitely not enough. They're way, way far from enough. I come from the real estate industry. We are the largest employment generators. And I think our industry has been left high and dry, frankly. You know, there's a lot which could have been done, except for the extension of RERA dates and a couple of other things of refinancing of housing finance companies. Nothing has been done for the real estate sector, which employs a large amount of migrant labor and is the highest employment indicator.
So what would you have wanted, Uttav?
Of course, to start with, you know, one-time restructuring of loans. Real estate sector is in pain. Secondly, the extension of the 20% credit, which they've given to MSME sector, should have also been given to real estate sector because of the number of people that real estate employs. And a third would be an interest waiver, which I think should be there for a partial interest waiver, which should be across industry, I think.
Much of that would require recapitalization of banks? Because you're talking about a very large exposure then.
Yes. Look, this is a time, this is a special situation where the government needs to probably print money. I'm not saying it's a normal situation. And we're not in a normal situation. We've seen what the economies of the world are doing. And I think the Indian government needs to do step up as well.
Okay, Mahendra Swarup, let me bring you in. In terms of how do you see the roadmap from here on? We've got all sectors covered from infra to telecom to real estate across the board. How do you see the roadmap from here on?
Gauri, Mr. Swarup has been the chairman of the Indian Venture Capital Association. He ran a fund and he works with lots of entrepreneurs. And entrepreneurs feel that if they don't get enough capital over the next 30 to 90 days, some of their business may be endangered. They're already endangered. So, Mr. Swarup, I would like to bring you in to get the feeling and the feeling of desperation for capital that the entrepreneurs are having just now.
Yeah, my take on the reforms which have been announced by the government is that these are reforms. This is not relief. And I think the government has lost a very big opportunity of even imagining the proportion of the crisis which we are facing, not only on the social front, but on mainly on the economic front.
Okay.
I think the government has addressed issues which have been on the anvil for many years. There is nothing new which they have done which has not been discussed.
So what Mr. Swarup, you are essentially saying is that, you know, something I said earlier as well, that stimulus and reform are not interchangeable. They're separate issues.
Not interchangeable, yes.
And what is needed is stimulus right now. Yes, go ahead. Finish your point. Yeah.
I think what the industry was looking for exactly, stimulus, not reform. Reforms could have waited, but stimulus is what is required now. I think when the economy and the society is in ICU, what you're looking for COVID patients is ventilators. So there's no ventilators. There isn't hope for a vaccine. That's what the government has done. These reforms will trickle in after several years. And the execution is not easy. You're saying what you're addressing is the supply side. What is required is the demand side. So people like us, the middle class, the migrant laborers, the rural population should have been given straight cash into their account. So the demand itself would have actually reactivated and rekindled the industry and the supply chain. Now, the supply chain is totally in tatters. It will take not only a couple of months, but maybe a couple of years for the supply chain to really come into its original shape. Because it's not only India, India is interlinked with the global supply chain. The global supply chain is getting disrupted. So the only thing which can change things and change the scenario, and what is more important is the government should also address the sentiment. Sentiment play a very major role. So a lot of industries have been left out. If you heard the panelists here, so you have telecom complaining that they have been left out.
Tourism
has been left out.
Aviation.
You name, believe that they have been left out.
Okay.
So I think all of them are looking for immediate stimulus.
Anurag, you want to come in there? Tourism, travel, aviation, real estate, telecom. But yes, Anurag, you want to come in there?
Yeah, Mr. Swarup, I would say to you that the government has offered a scheme for MSMEs, for SMEs. So, some of the startups that you talk of would qualify in that. Of course, you could always say...
No, I'm not talking startups. Even MSMEs, right? What you have done is that you have made it easier for to get indebted. Most of the MSMEs are almost on the verge of collapse. They're already, their books are leveraged. So, they already owe so much to the bank, and then you expect the same guys to go back to the bank and say, let me lend me more. You have made it easier for them to borrow, but where are the stimulus? There have to be direct write-offs, there have to be tax incentives, there has to be GST relief. So these kind of things which could have been done very easily, right? The government has missed out on this opportunity. My thing is that I still appeal to the government. I think they need to come out immediately with a stimulus package. Reforms can wait. This is the crisis of global proportions, which most of us don't even can apprehend that when will it end and how will it end and what damage will it leave behind.
Let me then bring in.
It's anyone's guess. So there has to be a plan for continuous stimulus till we see COVID vanishing and also some sense of recovery. The only way this can be done is by improving the consumer sentiment
by putting money directly into the hands of the citizen, and that would itself will stimulate supply side.
Okay, let me then
that's
bring
what
in
is required.
Let me then bring in Mansi there, as somebody who runs an online venture. Respond to what Mr. Swaroop is saying there, that across the board there is pain, and he also mentioned that whether you talk about startups or MSMEs, the feeling sort of seems to be universal. Do you share that and echo that sentiment, or what is it that you would like to add in terms of the Big Bang reforms?
Hello everyone, good evening. Thanks for having me, Gauri and Anurag. I actually, to second the thought of Mr. Swaroop, I agree that it's a stimulus and reform is a long way there to come. However, as a startup and, you know, as a completely homegrown Indian brand, we invested 7 years in building a true Indian brand coming out of India. We at the jury are looking at this as an opportunity for a new India. You know, the package the government has announced, and I understand that it is not answering the problems for everyone. However, it is creating a very big opportunity for the value creation, which is in manufacturing and building up products, manufacturing and infrastructure. So, I also hear Mr. Swaroop on, people like MSMEs are already so leveraged, and government is just easing the process of taking more money on them. However, at the same time, we've seen a lot of startups and, ourselves also. I hugely believe in being agile and self-reliant. Very much in line with what Mr. Modi addressed the country, it is very important for us. And to some point, I also feel that we are also expecting maybe too much from the country at the moment. However, they need to address each and every business at the same time. I remember somebody correctly pointed out that in about 60 to 90 days, a lot of startups will not even have the money to survive. So it is your ability to stay relevant and agile and being self-reliant in the lockdown times and then come out of it. I mean, India has this great opportunity to, it's time for new India now. China has been there doing the manufacturing, and you have Oppo's and Xiaomi's of the world coming from China. However, it is time to bring out the brands from India and make them the global brands. So starting from taking care of all the demand and making locally, which is producing domestically, supporting a lot of homegrown brands is what government has already done, and we have been very happy about it. Yeah.
Okay, Anurag, you want to come in there in terms of where entrepreneurs stand?
Yeah. Is that what she's referring to? Is if you look at the Chinese come in hordes. Rajan comes from the telecom sector. They not only brought the handset manufacturers, they brought the retailers. They got cheap banks from their money from their bank. See, as a business, there is a labor cost or a people cost. There is a cost of capital and there is a cost of land if you're in manufacturing. If you're not, then it's the cost of capital and the cost of people. Now, on all those things, the government of China supported Chinese entrepreneurs in both. I think it's the time for the government not to worry about fiscal deficit, not to worry about what rating agencies feel. We need to engage with rating agencies and explain our fundamentals are strong. So what Mansi is referring is that one sectoral approach is needed. Second, the government will reap dividends and the country will reap dividends if the government can provide capital now. I think that's what I'm hearing over the last 4 days, very vocally from each stakeholder, that capital support is needed. At this stage, we also have Janardan Pandey, who is an entrepreneur, mid-sized entrepreneur. He had a QSR business which has been decimated. He has a media and communication business, which again has been marginalized because brands have stopped. So Janardan, as a mid-sized entrepreneur, how do you see the package? I know you're a positive person, but let's be realistic about what's working and what's not working.
Yeah, the positivity is fine. Now we have to look at it that we are not dealing with the recession. If it was 2008, this is the best, you know, any government could have done. You know, announcing such kind of, you know, opening up, ending many license cards, you know, permit procedures and everything. We are not dealing with the recession. We are dealing with the depression. You know, to come out of depression, we need financial fitness and we need mental fitness. Now, look at ourselves. We have a, you know, significant exposure to aviation, you know, travel and tourism. We have exposure to real estate and so many other industries. Now, those sectors are completely destroyed. They have no monies to pay us. Now, as a, you know, as a mid-sized company, I cannot borrow and, you know, pay to the market, which we owe. We cannot borrow and, you know, then start paying our GST and, you know, TDS implications and everything. The borrowing can only save guard us for 3 months. It's not like that, you know, I take a loan and I discharge my obligations toward PF, GST, TDS and all that. Unless and until these sectors, they are given a huge benefit and they can restart their business and start advertising and start, you know, doing business with us and start paying our old dues, we won't survive. Number two is like, you know, where the demand will come from. After 3 months, people are being laid off, there are salary cuts, you know, and there is a, you know, bad days coming, you know, ahead. Now, how do you, you know, ignite the consumption? How do you ignite the confidence into people? What will make them come out and spend money? Because currently they are buying essential services, and essential services is not economy. You know, some people are involved.
What are your asks, Kanardhan? What are your asks of the government? Yeah. What would you like the package to have? The so-called stimulus, what would you like to see in that?
Yeah, so what they have done is good. That's very good. You know, that is opening up a lot of opportunities. Now, what they have to do, that put money in the hands of lower middle class, which is a consumer class. You know, maybe they can leave behind rich people, you know, on individual basis. So that is number one. Number two, they have to give the, you know, their industries which are completely shut down. Like I said, you know, travel and tourism, completely gone. Like, you know, aviation, completely gone. How government plans to start them, and unless they start, the economy will not move. We cannot remain in our districts and cities and all that, and, you know, still we can say that we are opening up. This is not going to work out. The government needs to put money. Now, how they will manage it, that unless they put the money, will, this is a depression. It's very clear from pure economics point of view, this is a depression. Unless the mood is lifted up, unless people are confident, they are taken care of financially, they will not be able to survive. So we need a big booster, and that only cash can bring in.
Thank you.
Okay.
The government should find ways of looking after entrepreneurs, of, you know, getting the demand back, and that can only happen by government spending, whether it's on a macro level or infrastructure project, on a micro level by a direct money transfer or a salary,
yes,
support to MSMEs instead of just a loan.
Okay.
Mr. Kanodia, Hemant, you still there?
If, yes.
If you're a large organization, you work with an even a larger set of entrepreneurs and you lend to them. The government has been talking of how infrastructure spending will go up. Tell us, what are your suggestions to the government? The government knows, but just to reiterate, you also wrote a letter to the Prime Minister a couple of weeks back. So take us through that.
See, I think that basically the solutions to these problems are not very complicated. They are simple solutions. And that is what we have been writing to the Prime Minister, to the Finance Minister and the RBI Governor from time to time, sector-wise. Initially, what is the most important thing at present is liquidity. So how do you bring in liquidity to all the entrepreneurs, to businesses? It is not only the small MSME, because if you are addressing the MSME issues and if you are not addressing the larger companies go bankrupt. Then the MSMEs also will not get the money.
Because MSMEs, you know, everyone is relying on the large companies.
Yeah, so everyone is linked. So the first thing which the government should do ASAP, which is not going to cost the government a single part, is allow a one-time restructuring to all the borrowers by the banks. It will save the banks and it will save the borrowers, because there is no harm in doing it. You have certain norms. Those norms are good. In good times, but in times which are absolutely abnormal times, you have to take action, which is decisive. So this is not going to cost the government anything. It will give respite to all the companies, because it is not just a 90 days moratorium, because after 90 days, after the 30 years of free, how will people get money? Money is not going to just fall down from the sky. The second thing which we suggested to the government was to provide liquidity. There are a large number of construction companies, contractors, suppliers, vendors, whose payments are outstanding with the government. And the government, they do not pay, whether it be okay. The central government or the state government. So release those particular payments. Many of the cases are stuck up in arbitration awards, litigations, disputes. So get it resolved over a period of 30 to 60 days and just release that money. Because again, that is the money which is due to the industry, to the contractors, to the small guys, to the big guys. So everyone gets, again, liquidity in their hands, and the government doesn't have to go for a fiscal deficit. The third is that there are a lot of tax disputes and tax refunds which are pending, not only with individuals, but with corporates. And it is in litigations. So get it resolved over a period of 30 to 60 days time. Again, it releases liquidity. So by these measures, almost 4 to 5 lakh people can come into the economy. And that is their due. So
okay.
The industries will get the money immediately coming into the hands.
Okay.
Sector. So we have suggested for each sector a very simple solution. So instead of 20 lakh crore, our plan to the government was to spend 20,000 crore and you will get the economy back at 5% GDP.
Okay, so I'm gonna come in there. I know Dr. Mantha has to come in, former chairman of AICT, and we're going to bring him in terms of the impact as far as education is concerned. But a very quick break we take, come back on the other side. Dr. Mantha, on the changes as far as the education landscape is now set to see, how much of that is going to have a long-term impact in the sector and its dynamics? We come back and talk more after this very short break.
आपको afterlife और next life और इन चीजों में आप believe करते हैं?
Believe नहीं, मैं जानता हूँ. बिलीव उसी में करना पड़ता है जो हम जानते नहीं. ये बहुत आसान है, ये सब जानना कोई बड़ी बात नहीं. 3 घंटे टाइम लेके आप भी बैठ जाओगे तो आपको भी, आप हम एक प्रोसेस कराते हैं, एटर्निटी प्रोसेस जब ध्यान का, और ध्यान में आप गहराई में उतरोगे तो आपको खुद को पता चलेगा पास्ट जन्म कहाँ था अपना, हम क्या कर रहे थे. ये सब जानना कोई बड़ी मुश्किल की बात नहीं.
डेढ़ महीने से पूरे देश में लॉकडाउन था. कोरोना की वजह से सब कुछ बंद था. लेकिन हमेशा के लिए तो लॉकडाउन नहीं हो सकता ना. अब हम सबको पूरी जिम्मेदारी के साथ काम करना है, अपने परिवार और देश की बेहतरी के लिए. हम अगर पूरे अनुशासन से रहेंगे तभी कोरोना पर कंट्रोल हो पाएगा.
What industry captains are saying as far as the big bang reforms and the mega stimulus package that the government announced. Dr. Mantha, as someone who understands the education space very well, tell us the kind of changes that the landscape is now set to see, and more importantly, its economic ramifications. No one would have thought or imagined an empty quota with no coaching classes happening, but that has happened. And obviously, all that is going to lead to some long-term ramifications as well.
Yeah, then first of all, good evening and thank you for having me on the show. There is a profound effect on education as well, I mean, like all the other sectors that have been affected. Some of the initiatives that the government announced are probably good, but there is a lot of a lot could have been done. The opportunity in part seems to be a little wasted. For example, announcement of private players like Tata Sky and Airtel tying up to provide the video content, online video content and so on. That's a good idea to reach the probably the unreached, and also the coordinating with the states for at least 4 hours on the Swayamprabha channel and things like that. But then higher education is not only about online education post COVID. Online education has always been there, and some effort should have been done to bring in the blended part of education into the university systems. This was an opportunity to bring in that, build both online and the competency-based skills that are required within the universities. Now, in that sense, I thought the entire package should also have looked at the Skill India program, the Startup India program, and the Make in India program, which has not been done at all. For example, the Skill India program, the vocationalization of education should have been institutionalized within the school systems. Maybe, compulsorily an additional division could have been started where skills could have been institutionalized. That has not been done. As far as Startup India is concerned, the education somewhere has missed the bus in the sense that it has not been connected to entrepreneurship. It has not been connected to the startup ecosystem that would be required from a university's perspective. Today we are looking at Industry 4.0, where specialized skills are required, and the entry of AI and machine learning, those kind of things are disrupting the entire system. So we really need labor 4.0, and in order to build the competency-based skills required for labor 4.0 have completely been missed out. And finally, the Make in India concept, which is a great paradigm of the government of India, should have been linked to the higher education system at this point of time. Certain amount of budget should have been provided for that, in the sense that we could have easily taken the Fraunhofer model of Germany, where the industry could have been dotted into the university system and skills would have been built. Now that would have created a great opportunity, and the appropriate budget should have been provided for that purpose.
Okay. Anurag, you want to come in there on specifically those Matthew. Points?
Yeah. You know, the reason, Gauri, you're doing it from your studio or home, or I'm doing it from home. The reason we have this telecom possible is technology. It's the networks on which we are riding. Now, the telecom industry, which will enable this new 3C economy, the caring, collaborative, contactless economy, the telecom sector has been left out. Because if this enablement of technology doesn't happen, then everything else that we're talking of, e-telemedicine, we're talking of e-learning, we're talking of, Dr. Mantra talked about the university of future and our skilling. What about your sector? What would you have you like to see specifically from the FM and the PM?
So Anurag, thank you again. I think the first thing that you'll notice is that we are saddled with a whole ton of debt that came out as a result of these enormous bidding for spectrum, which was put at,
outlandish
bidding prices. I'm sorry. So I think to say this, look, give us some freedom to either, pay this over longer periods of time so that you can get liquidity back to invest in our networks, hire the people, roll out the fiber. People have been complaining, oh, our speeds are going down. We're not getting coverage. And, we're working from home and, the coverage there is inadequate. And so we're saying is that there's plenty of work for us to do so that we can take the revenue. Because this is one industry that fortunately has done relatively well in this particular area. So instead of the government taking
30%, it has enabled other industries to do it. It was always an enabler. Now it's become a super enabler, if I may say.
Yeah, so thank you. So I'm saying is that leave the 30% in the hands of the industry. Why take it back by way of adjusted gross revenue and everything else? Allow us to take this money and put it back into our networks and into the economy, hire the people, get them back working as more and more people get back into productive work environments. As you rightly said, Sarah, they depend on our networks in order to conduct economic activity. So there's every reason to focus on it. And again, we're disappointed that the FM has not taken into consideration the dynamic and the productive nature of our networks and incentivize this through means that don't necessarily put the exchequer at great risk.
But if I were in the finance ministry, I would say our sources of revenue have been usually depleted.
Yes.
And we need to look at certain
prices. I asked this right at the beginning, Anurag, to Rajan Matthews. In fact, that was the first question I asked him.
Relatively speaking.
Exactly. That was the first question I asked Rajan Matthews, was about the fact that stretched finances will mean no leeway in terms of streamlining of levies. But go ahead, Mr. Matthews. Yes.
Gauri, let me just say this. I mean, you look at the international forums, right? You'll notice money has now become cheap. People are giving it at zero to negative interest rates, right? So I think what we have to understand is that can we begin to start looking at where this cheap money is? It's not that it is, very highly, priced. In India, it is. So we have to be able to look at the government sovereignly going out and trying to determine where it can get this type of borrowings from so it can turn around, reduce the interest burden on the interest. And when I was looking at some of the issues, for example, in the US, they told companies, SMEs and MSEs, right? They said, listen, we will give you X amount of money if you keep your people paid. All right. And if you keep your people paid for 3 months, that money becomes an outright grant. You don't have to repay the government.
Canada.
Thank you. So I'm saying that these are the types of incentivized notions where it's.
I mean, it is unfair to compare Indian economy to Caribbean economy and the state of coffers and revenue of the Indian, financial system to Canada. We are a unique country. We need unique solutions. We can take best practices from anywhere. But it would be unfair to compare, you know, that the government has a very tight fiscal leeway. So what do you say to that, Ravi?
So Anurag, I'm saying is that we are one of the richest countries in terms of gold hoardings. What are we doing with this gold? Let me ask. So we've got to be able to free up the monetized value of what people are sitting on or governments are sitting on through some means and get this to sort of back up some of our sovereign borrowings if necessary, right? These would be, asset-based things that could happen. So I think there are opportunities. You're absolutely right, Mr. Anurag. We don't need to look at America and Europe, but I think we can begin to say, look, as an integrated global process, we can begin to say, look, are there things that we can do that we dovetail into the rest of the world's economy to kickstart the supply chain in terms of the demand factor? I think we need to go back to the demand factor. I mean, this is the age-old conundrum, right? Supply and demand have to intersect at some point. You can't continue to say, I'll do the stimulus on the supply side without saying, where's the demand intersection?
Yes.
That's when things begin to happen. Thank you.
Yes, indeed. And India is also uniquely positioned in the sense that we offer the cheapest call rates in the world and, of course, expect best 5G level of service. So let's also be realistic there. And, let's understand the plight of telecom at some level. Though I agree that, yes, finances are stretched. But, let's then take this forward in terms of a dialogue that you would like to have with, let's say, policymakers, because I firmly believe that despite that announcement, I think that the government is open to a second round of suggestions.
Absolutely.
And a larger roadmap. And Uttav, what would that be, if this conversation were to continue with the finance minister and North Bloc on an ongoing basis, what would be that one suggestion that you would like to give?
I think liquidity is the key. I think everybody is looking for liquidity and it's not limited only to MSMEs. So the lifeline has to be given to everybody. Everybody is going to be dependent on a larger industry. So liquidity to larger industries, to industries which employ a lot of people like hotels, real estate, and all the other sectors which are affected badly. Liquidity, I think, is the key.
Okay, liquidity.
I agree to that, actually, Gauri. There's one point I would like to make here. Even as a medium-sized organization, Mr. Rajan Matthews said earlier, and Mr. Kanodia mentioned it, even if government can give us a relaxation, like India needs one of those big $1 billion days, for at an organizational level. So even if India gives like a GST waiver for a month for organization, or even if they can release payments on time. So in this time, everything is on advance payment and at a higher rate. So smaller organizations and smaller brands like us, we procure and give it to government supply, but they pay us 90 days later, which is totally not fair. I think that's one point from where they can immediately provide liquidity to people because there is huge demand at the government level, both at center and state. There are huge tenders being released, but with huge payment terms. So where is that money going to come from? That money is not available in the market.
Okay. Mr. Kanodia, you want to come in there? That one specific suggestion or an urgent basis request for the government, and then I get in, Anurag?
I think that I would again repeat that what is required by the government is that how liquidity can come in the hands of the people and ASAP, because the more delay that we do, it's almost about 2 months, and when the lockdown opens up gradually, and once the moratorium of 90 days is completed by the banks to the industry, all the industries will become sick. Unfortunately, now the government is also coming out that people cannot go to the IBC, so they cannot file for bankruptcy. So you have a situation where a person is fallen sick, he cannot go to the hospital, so therefore he has to wait for 1 year before he gets the medicine.
Okay, Anurag, you know, the fact is, I'm going to come to you, sir.
You know, Gauri, you alluded to it, and I want successive broadcast said that this is stage one, this is phase one, this is installment one. And we should expect from the government, but the reason Hemant is an entrepreneur is because he was able to build something on his own. The reason Vaibhav, Uddhav is an entrepreneur, he could build something in Manasi, JP, Dr. Mamta was of course a policy maker, now he's the chancellor of a university. What I want to go to Mr. Swaroop is, when you ask the government for direct, what will be the route? How will the implementation happen? What is the criteria government will use? Give us some aspects of
I have a, it's
very easy. But how
we come from an industry which take big risk and we let the sick die. Now, everyone is asking for relief and liquidity in the hands of industry. Like, let me take the example. I know we have a representative from the hospitality industry here. Aviation and hospitality, we know that even if you give them a lifeline, they will not survive, because the new normal, people will not travel, people will not go and stay in hotels. So the government has to choose between the industries which will survive on their own, and there'll be a demand, there'll be a need, right? And let some of them die, whom we know for the next 2, 3, 4 years will not be able to survive on their own. So there has to be, like, I keep coming back to comparison with a hospital of a COVID facility, that ventilators are given to people who they know will survive. People with comorbidities are not actually given ventilators. So doctors in Europe and Italy and Spain have let go of life knowing that they will not survive. So when you have scarce resources, the government, it's a very extremely tough job which the FM and the Prime Minister are having today. They don't know really whom to give the lifeline to. That everyone is in this panel is asking for a lifeline, liquidity. But you don't know that how long this crisis will last. No one can even hazard a guess.
Absolutely. And you know,
the government does not have limitless ability to keep printing currency.
No, it doesn't. Even the world's
economies in the economies like US and Europe,
even the world's largest economy cannot do that. Yes. Even the world's largest economy cannot do that. The $3 trillion that...
We are talking about migratory labor. But when the problem arises with the non-migratory labor, the corporate workers, the people who are being laid out in the urban centers.
Yes.
Can you imagine the lifeline which they will need? You can bust the migratory labor back into the villages.
Yes. Right?
But what will you do with thousands of people being laid off by startups every day? What will you do? These are non-migratory, blue-collared and white-collared workers.
Exactly.
What do you do with them? So the government has to come up with relief to these people.
So CMIE data for the month of April says 24 million people, that's 2 crores, in the age group of 20 to 29 have been laid off recently. Already unemployment levels, again I'm quoting CMIE data, was 25% in urban India and a little under that in rural India. So yes, those are serious concerns in terms of job losses. And Mr. Pandey, how do we ensure job creation? Because, you know, 10 million people get added to Indian workforce. Look at the scale at which job losses are anyways taking place, something that Mr. Swaroop pointed out. Startups are firing. So is, at some point of time, some of the larger companies as well, as they focus on saving cash.
I think, Gauri, I'll just come in. Excuse me. Yes, Gauri, can I just butt in here now?
Yes.
Sorry. I think the danger which we run today is the demographic advantage which we keep saying, the demographic dividend.
Could be withered away.
The people, it's going to be frittered away because the people who are going to be laid off are the millennials.
Yes, exactly. As I said, 20 to 29 is the age group. Yes.
So it's a very, very tough situation which we are not even envisaging.
These are people, absolutely.
Community, right? We actually invest with a very optimistic viewpoint, but we plan for the worst.
Absolutely. Yes, Mr. Pandey.
If you look at the people whom we were banking upon, that the millennials are the people who are going to spend in this country.
Absolutely. They are driving our consumption engines. They are driving our consumption engines. Absolutely.
They will become victims of this tragedy.
Absolutely.
They will become the biggest victims of this tragedy.
Yes.
Janardhan, you represent the services sector. You're a communication services agency. Now, marketing has come to 20%, 15% of many people. So tell us what's going in the mind of an entrepreneur. What are you really thinking? And what do you, just to build on, Gauri gave you statistics about 2 crore plus people losing jobs. What's going in your mind and what do you expect from the government?
So basically what is happening, see, if you ask me, so I have interest into food business and media advertising, events. What is happening that I'm not worried so much about my, you know, today's business, you know, March, April, May, June, July. We all are dependent on other businesses if they perform, if they sell, if people buy, if they are able to, you know, transport, distribute, then only our advertising business will run. Now, what is happening that, you know, every day the situation is changing. Now, you rightly said this is the phase one of the reforms. I understand that. But that phase one should not be the long-term one. The phase one, we needed that, you know, put money in the hands of people. Now, we had a moratorium of 3 months, which is ending in June. Now, and that is an accumulated installment that people will need to pay towards that.
And interest on top of it.
Exactly.
Interest on top of it.
Exactly. Yeah. Exactly. Yeah. Interest is accumulating. Yes.
Yeah, and there is a whole lot of cash into it for the credit card, you know, deferments. There is a, you know, 3.5%, 3 to 4%, you know, the monthly interest being charged. The penalties are not there, which is huge. So this, when this problem is, and we are living in an abnormal situation. See, I am telling you, the government needs to give us a hand holding. It's a 4 to 6 months period. This is an abnormal time. This is not going to remain there. I still feel that we are going to travel. We are not going to live with the mask. You know, there will be, the world has seen enough problems and we have survived. There will be medicines. I don't follow anything what WHO is saying, but there will be medicines. In 6 to 9 months, we will start traveling, we will start eating. It will take time to instill the confidence. But in this 4 to 6 to 9 months, we need government to do the hand-holding. We cannot be in the survival mode, you know, feeding the poor. But from where the demand will come? When you will give money to the lower middle class? The poor people, they will live anyhow. I'm not saying anything, but that is a fact of life. Who will drive the economy? It is the lower middle class, it is the middle class, it is the upper middle class. Unless they have money to spend. So they are under stress of, you know, accumulated EMIs, you know, the salaries are cut, the people are losing jobs. Now anybody, when the depression comes when people who have money, they start, you know, saving
on cash. Yes.
Recession is when people are, you know, not having money. Certain people are not having money, they are not spending, so there is a slowdown. Depression is when mentally you are sick, you know, the entire population, and the when people, they have the money but they're not willing to invest because they don't see, you know, attractive enough. So this entire accumulation of, you know, problems, government need to, you know, just fire it up. These long-term things are good, but that is, they are not going to help us. Number two, then one, Mr. Matthew was saying, see, we are talking about being Atmanirbhar or self-reliant. Now, if you look at our industries, you know, it is dominated by all multinationals. The fact is that the annual fund cost is 2 to 3%. My annual fund cost is 10%. So how can I compete with them? It's not possible. We just survive to an extent. You know, so once we want to be competitive globally, we cannot be self-reliant unless we are globally competitive.
Okay, Mr. Manta, you want to come in there? I'm running out of time. Yeah. Mr. Manta, you want to come in there? I'm running out of time. Yes.
Yeah, you know, Gauri, I want to say that, you know, in the discussion of the last 4 days, the one thing that is coming out is, it's called a stimulus, but it's more a reform. Yes, on compliance, there is a relaxation, that's welcome. MSMEs are getting a loan, that's welcome.
Yes.
And some people, it will help a lot of people.
But it's not a booster dose, that's what you're saying. It's not a booster dose.
Has to happen. The execution has to happen from this week. As of yesterday, the banks should be giving loans, even on what the government has announced. So I would like to ask all the panelists one by one, and start with Dr. Mantha and come back to Hemant, is what is that one thing you want from government this week and next week?
Yeah, I mean, there are some short-term requirements and some long-term requirements. Since March, many universities have not really done any classroom teaching and things like that. So therefore, there must be a mechanism to get them to complete their... some of the universities have really gone into their own self-driven online education and things like that. But many universities have been left out from that process. So the assessment system must be appropriately judged by the concerned regulators.
Mm.
That's in the short term. Now, what happens in the... if we really do not do that, then the current semester, current
yes.
year is anyway disturbed. And it will also lead to the new year being extended beyond, beyond operational possibilities.
Yes.
So now, in the long term, the skills must be institutionalized, and therefore the competency-based skills that are required for Labour 4.0 will be taken care of within the university systems.
Okay. All right. Very quickly. Let's go down the panel. Yes, Mr. Kanoria.
Yeah, so I think that basically very simple, just ask the banks to do a one-time restructuring for all borrowers. Second is all the payments which are stuck up with the government by way of disputes, legal disputes here, they just release
yes.
that. It will release 4 lakh to 5 lakh crore into the economy
yes.
immediately. If this can be done in the next 30 days, I think that it will alleviate a lot of problems
okay.
for people to
get. It will release money, yes. Yes. Okay. Very quickly, Mansi. Yes.
Yes. I agree totally, Mr. Kanoria. Number one point government can do is to immediately infuse, pay the people off. Even if it is not 30-day, 90-day term, just pay them immediately on advance. We have to have the money running into the system. Also, because of the support that government has, the stimulus that government has given us right now, every organization has this responsibility of
yes.
you know, looking at this challenge as an opportunity and maybe
yes.
try to be a little more relevant and just not being the way they were. India is going
okay.
to be, COVID is not going to go anywhere in 2-3 years. So we have to learn to live with COVID
yes.
for 3 years.
Yes.
And for that, businesses will have to change. And the least that we can do is to
yes.
not fire people.
Okay. All
yes.
right. Very quickly, Mr. Poddar, completely out of time. Yes.
Again, I agree with Mr. Kanoria. One-time restructuring of loans to all businesses, all loans outstanding, and also additional and fresh capital to be infused to specifically real estate, hotels, and sectors which employ large number of people.
Okay.
Those are the two things.
Okay. Mr. Matthews?
We are the only industry that's making money. Leave the money in the hands of the industry so that we can turn around and invest and hire people. That's
okay.
what we ask for.
Okay. Yes. Mr. Swaroop?
I think I would agree with Mr. Matthew. I think this is a time when you don't have to think out of the box, but have to break the box. I think I totally agree with him that leave as much as you can with the industry and
okay.
the individuals, consumers. So I think I'll look for tax holidays. No GST, no tax, no personal tax, no income tax for the next 6 months. The government has to do something very dramatic to improve the sentiment
okay.
and put as much money, leave as much money behind with the people who will
okay.
actually invest and also buy.
All right. Yes. Yes, Mr. Pandey, very quickly, please.
So basically, you know, the tax holiday, the GST, you know, slabs can be changed and it can be postponed. Give subsidy to the consumer, like, you know, individuals on the interest that they have accumulated, you know, make TDS refund very fast, you know, that will give some liquidity. And, you know, it is to make sure that we survive and then we pay back. That's all. And make sure that banks are lending. It's just the policy announcement. Banks are completely clueless. And more so about the private sector banks.
You know, I have completely run out of time. But the fact is, RBI should have actually reduced rates by 2%. Yes.
Yes, execution is key. I'd only say execution and front loading of whatever has been announced, just execute that well as a first step and make sure it happens now. That's it.
Yes, front loading of that expenditure is so crucial right now. Thanks much for watching this very special broadcast.
Thank you,
thanks much to all the panelists.
For more such videos, subscribe to the NewsX YouTube channel, hit the bell icon.